It's very obvious that it's Christmas time again, right? Are you excited? I still remember when I was still a young boy, I was always very excited when it's Christmas time. Now that I'm already grown up, I notice that my excitement, you know, the level of excitement goes down every year. I don't know why. Maybe it's because they say Christmas is for little kids. Actually, if you know the real essence, the true spirit of Christmas, you won't say that it's just for kids. Actually, it's for everybody, right? If you go out there on the street and ask people what Christmas is all about, in all likelihood, many people will answer you, Christmas is about giving, right? Of course, other people will say, oh, Christmas is about peace, Christmas is about Jesus, and so on and so forth. There are many reasons out there, but I bet you, many people will say Christmas is about giving. Now, I really don't agree that Christmas is all about giving, but I would have to agree that one of the most important themes of Christmas is giving, right? Everybody say giving. Now, because of this, we give gifts to each other. We remember how the Lord has been so generous to us. And the ultimate expression of that was when He gave His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to the world in order to save the world, right? So here we see God demonstrating what giving is all about. And because of this, we want to reflect His giving heart, His generous heart. And so we also, in one way or the other, share our resources with each other. We give gifts to one another. And that is good. However, strictly speaking, giving gifts to each other falls short of the true spirit of Christmas giving. If we are saying that Christmas is about giving, specifically the giving of God, and we want to reflect the generosity of God in our lives, I tell you, our giving gifts to each other falls short of the true spirit or the true essence of Christmas giving. Now, you might ask me, Pastor Rich, what is the true essence or the true spirit of Christmas giving if you are saying that we fall short? I'll take you back to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7. Why don't we look at it? 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7. Here in the second letter of the Apostle Paul to the Corinthian believers, he exhorted them or he encouraged them to excel also in the grace of giving or the ministry of giving. It says here in verse 7 of chapter 8 of the second letter of the Apostle Paul to the Corinthians, it says here, but as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in this act of grace also. He is referring to the gift of giving. Now, you have to understand the situation of the Corinthian believers. At the time, you would, you know, see them growing in many aspects of their spiritual lives. Name it, faith. They were growing their trust in the Lord. You know, they believed in the Lord for great miracles to happen, and miracles happened. They were also growing in their the other areas of their lives, in the ministry. They were exercising their different spiritual gifts with the zeal. In fact, to the point of a fault. You know the story, the Corinthian believers, right? They were already abusing their spiritual gifts. But putting that aside, they were really serving the Lord. They were exercising their spiritual abilities. And so we will see here that as far as faith, as far as ministries of the speech, as far as knowledge in the Bible, knowledge on God, and their earnestness, and so on and so forth, they were all growing. They were all, excelling in the different areas of their spiritual lives. However, the Apostle Paul noticed one area where they were lagging behind. You know what area was that? It was the area of their ministry of giving. In the area of giving, or as far as giving to the Lord, giving to the work of the Lord, giving to others, to meet the needs of others, was concerned, they were lagging behind. And so the Apostle Paul says to them in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7, but as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, seeing that you excel in this act of grace also. which is the grace of giving or the ministry of giving. Now, I don't know with you, but perhaps you are also excelling in the different areas of your spiritual lives. And yet, when it comes to giving, you lag behind. Or maybe not just in the area of giving, maybe in other areas of your spiritual life, maybe in the area of service, you're lag behind. Maybe you have different spiritual gifts and talents that you are not yet using to serve the Lord. Some, you know, in some areas of your life, you are doing well, but in other areas, maybe you are not really growing. I encourage you, grow. Check these areas out and make it a point that you pursue growth in these areas. Amen? Because the Lord wants us to grow in all our areas. The Lord wants us to serve Him, love Him. The Lord wants us to devote ourselves to Him in all areas of our life. We cannot hold back some areas. I don't know if some of you here are holding back certain areas from God. Are there people here who are saying, "Oh Lord, no problem with my money, no problem with my time, no, but Lord, don't touch this area. That is closed. That is sacred to me. No one touches it. But I have no problem, Lord, serving you in other areas of my life. I have no problem growing in other areas of my life, but not this one." Do you have areas like that in your life? Listen up. The Word of God says, "Love the Lord your God with what? All your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind." It means He demands, He requires from us our totality. And that goes without saying that He wants all aspects of our lives to be devoted to Him. As such, we have to grow in all areas of their lives. So maybe some of you can identify some areas of your life where you are not really growing, or you are performing, you know, below par. Why don't you ask the Lord to help you grow in these areas? I've been in the ministry for many years now, being a Christian for almost 30 years now, and in the full-time ministry for 20 years now since I graduated from the Bible school. And I've met so many kinds of Christians. Now, some Christians I've met are people who are very, you know, zealous in service. They would spend time, energy, joining this ministry, joining that ministry, no problem. But it's very interesting because when it comes to money, they're kind of stingy. Okay? They say, "We have an outreach there, let's go. Pastor needs some assistant here, let's go. Do we need people in the choir? Let's go." They are very good at that. But once it comes to money, they have a hard time, you know, pulling some money out of their pockets, as if there's a glue inside. No, so that when they enter their hands, enter their pocket, they had a hard time pulling it out. Others are different, are the opposite. They have no problem giving out money, but when you say to them, "Oh, why don't you join us, don't join the Bible study, join the outreach," they won't. And they don't even come to church every, you know, regularly. Not to mention that they are not exercising their spiritual gifts. So we have different kinds of people in the church. Those who would give time, energy, but little money. Those who would give much money, little time for the ministry. We have all those people in church. Okay? We all have to grow. Of course, I am very happy that you are spending time serving, exercising spiritual gifts. I'm also happy that you are giving, but we have to make sure that all areas of our lives are growing. Because again, the Lord said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength." Amen? Specifically here, the problem of the Corinthian believers, by and large, was that they were not excelling in the gift of or the ministry of generosity. And so the Apostle Paul tells them in verse 7, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7, "But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in this act of grace also, that grace or the ministry of giving. Now, the Apostle Paul gave them the ultimate model of generosity to follow. Look at verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9 says here, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, by his poverty, might become rich." You see that? Again, the Apostle Paul says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was what? Rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, by his poverty, might become rich." We ask this question, in what way or in what sense was Jesus rich before he came down to earth? And in what sense was he or he became poor? Now, let's first talk about the first question. Before the incarnation, by the way, when I say incarnation, I'm talking about the fact that Jesus Christ came down to earth and took human nature, or he became flesh. You see, God basically is a spirit, doesn't have flesh, doesn't have this human body. But 2,000 years ago, Jesus was born into this world, and during the time he took on humanity, he became human. That's what we call in theology incarnation. Incarnation, becoming flesh. Now, before Jesus became flesh or became human being, or before the incarnation, Jesus was rich in the sense that he lived in heaven in all divine glory. He lived in heaven in all divine glory. Heaven was his home, right? Now, I tell you, the beauty of heaven cannot be compared to anything on earth. I mean, the totality of it, it just goes through the stratosphere. Incomparable, unfathomable. That's the beauty of heaven. You know, talk about, you know, a perfect place, talk about streets of gold and many other things. I had the privilege of visiting or entering mansions, beautiful houses, both here in the Philippines and in abroad. And every time I would enter these houses, I would just stand in awe. Because I love beautiful houses. I love beautiful cities. I love beautiful countries, especially first world countries. So I stand in awe. But guess what? Even if you will combine all these things, all the beauty that you see in these houses, combine them, I tell you, they are nothing compared to the beauty of heaven. I'm not only talking about the beauty, but even the quality of things inside. I've been to houses where they have chandeliers worth 1 million, 2 million, 3 million. Have you seen chandeliers like those? Just one chandelier costing 1 million or 2 million, 3 million? I've entered houses like that. And you say, whoa, these lights? 1 million, 2 million, 3 million? Boy, that's expensive. I tell you, even if you will put together all the chandeliers in the world, all the golds in the world, they are nothing compared to the beauty of heaven. And that is the home of the Lord Jesus Christ before he came to earth. He lived in heaven in all divine glory. In heaven, he was king. King of kings, Lord of lords. And mind you, he had millions of servants. Angels at that. No ordinary servants. Right? When we visit houses where they have, when we see our friends or our relatives who are rich, and we visit their house and we see them having a fleet of, servants, we are awed, right? Oh, there's a cook, there are two cooks, there are several drivers, there are gardeners, there are laundry washers, and so on and so forth. We are just awed. But get this. In heaven, the Lord had millions of angels, powerful beings doing his bidding. He was rich in that sense. Before he came to earth, he lived in heaven in all divine glory. That's why he was rich. Not only that, before or at that time, he had all divine prerogatives at his disposal. You see, he was God originally. And whatever he wanted to do before he came to earth, he did. He was all-powerful, right? The Bible tells us God is almighty. Or in theology, we call that omnipotence of God. He can do anything he wanted to do. Name it. Right? Of course, he also knows everything. He can peer into the future. In fact, he decides what will happen in the future. That's how powerful he is. So aside from living in heaven in all divine glory before he came to earth, he also had all the divine prerogatives at his disposal. No wonder he was rich. Right? But listen to this. For the sake of sinful mankind, and that includes you and me, for our sake, Jesus became poor. Do you realize that? Jesus became poor. In what sense did he become poor for our sake? One, he left heaven to live on earth. Right? To those of you here who have already visited first world countries, we see a glaring disparity between their living conditions and our living conditions here in a third world country such as our Philippines. Right? That's a big difference. And sometimes when we hear people who are already like Filipinos who have already migrated to the States and later on they decided to come back to the Philippines, we say, why? What's the point? Why come back? I still remember 10 years ago, my family and I decided to come back from the U.S. I was pastoring a church there and come back and serve this church. My pastor friends, you wouldn't believe this. My pastor friends who were also in the States were saying, why are you going back? Pastors from the Philippines wants to come over to the U.S. Now you're here. You already have papers. You're legal. Why would you decide to go back? They cannot, understand. Right? Of course, the Lord has His ways, has His plans. We just have to obey. The point is, first world and third world countries, there's a whole lot of difference. Now, let's talk about the difference between heaven and earth. How's that? If we pity people from first world countries moving to third world countries, how about God moving from heaven to earth? What's the difference? You cannot even measure the disparity, right? So in that sense, he became poor. He left heaven to live on earth. He also took on human flesh. I tell you, God originally, essentially, is spirit. He doesn't have human body. Human bodies will just limit you. But imagine this being, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the God who has created everything, allowing himself to be trapped in one human body. Can you imagine that? Let me just give you one example. Say, for example, now you're now an adult. You can do so many things. Okay? Your talents are fully developed. Your intelligence is fully developed. And then one day, say, for example, something miraculous happened. God said, okay, I'm going to place you inside the body of an 8-year-old kid. Maybe not an 8-year-old kid. I'm going to place you in the body of a 5-year-old kid. One who doesn't know how to tie his shoe, doesn't know how to change his clothes by himself. How's that? What would you feel? That's hard, right? Just imagine. If you want to do this, you can't do it. Don't even know how to tie your shoe. But you know that you know all these things, supposedly, because you are now an adult who's just trapped in the body of a five-year-old kid. Now imagine the situation of Jesus. King of kings, Lord of lords, creator, ruler of the entire universe. Here he is. God the Father says, you go down, be the savior of the world. First, you have to become a baby and grow normally. It was very hard, right? So in that sense, he also became poor when he took on human flesh. Aside from that, he also laid aside the exercise of his divine powers. In the incarnation, or when Jesus Christ became human being, he laid aside, or he put aside, the exercise of his divine powers. He was still God. Now, I want you to be very clear on this. Okay, this is theology. When Jesus Christ came to earth, although he took on human flesh, he was still God through and through. Jesus was 100% God and was also 100% human. He did not cease to be God when he came down to earth. But the thing was, he did not exercise his divine powers. He did not have an independent exercise of his divine powers. If ever he would perform a miracle, he had to make sure that it was the will of the Father for him to do so at the time. So it's very hard. Right? Have you ever experienced, you know, having so much ability to do something, and yet because of some situation, circumstances, certain things around you, you are prevented from doing so? Oh, you can't do that because technically you can't do that. Or you can't do that because of this factor or that factor. Have you ever experienced that? How many of you have experienced that? You can help. You can do it. You have the ability whatsoever, and yet you cannot do. Your hands are tied. Have you experienced that for sure? That's so frustrating. Right? Now, imagine God being trapped in the body of a human being and laying aside the independent exercise of his divine powers. How's that? How's that? Just like when he was, you know, struck in his face, he was beaten black and blue. Still remember the time when he was arrested? What did he say to his tormentors? I could easily send millions of angels, but I won't do that. Imagine, right? Then ultimately, of course, Jesus died on the cross. So for the sake of sinful mankind, Jesus became poor in the sense that he left heaven to live on earth, in the sense that he took on human flesh, and he laid aside the exercise of his divine powers, and ultimately he died on the cross. It was in that sense that Jesus, who was rich, became poor for our sake. Look with me in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 8. It says, "You have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God," meaning he had the substance of God. Now don't be confused with the word form, the English word form. The Greek word for that is the word morphe. And morphe does not only talk about, you know, outward appearance, but it talks about essence, substance, okay? So it says here, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form," or in the substance, in the essence of God, he himself was God, "did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form or the substance of a servant, a human being born in the likeness of man, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross." That's what Jesus did. He was rich, he was God, and yet when he came down to earth to save us, he took on humanity, and in that sense, he became a servant, he became poor. That is our model of generosity. Question, why did Jesus do this? Why did Jesus become poor for our sake, although he was rich? The answer is that we might become rich in the sense that we will receive the riches of salvation. Let me repeat that. The reason why Jesus became poor so that we will become rich. All of us. Rich in the sense that we will receive the riches of salvation. You see, spiritually speaking, we are all poor. We even deserve to go to hell. Right? It really doesn't matter what people think, where they will go after death. If they are not in Christ Jesus, they will all go to hell. We are spiritually poor to start with. But Jesus wants us to make rich. And so he became poor. He sacrificed himself so that we will receive the riches of salvation through him. What are the riches of salvation? Many things. Forgiveness for our sins, right? Peace, joy, glory in heaven, you know, eternal life, and so on and so forth. Being able to live in heaven, right? Jesus became poor so that we become rich in the sense of receiving the riches of salvation. Now the question is this. What kind of generosity did Jesus demonstrate for us to imitate? From this example, we see that he wants us to imitate a sacrificial kind of generosity. A sacrificial kind of generosity. I tell you, giving to others is one thing. Giving to others sacrificially is a whole different ballgame. Really. Because sacrificial giving means you have to let go of something that you want, perhaps you need, but for the sake of other people, you will forego your own convenience, you will forego of your own needs just to meet the needs of others. That's sacrificial giving. Linda Belleville, a Bible commentator, in his commentary on the book of 2 Corinthians in the IVP New Testament Commentary Series, said these words, and I quote, "Christ went from riches to rags so that we might go from rags to riches." Again, Christ went from riches to rags so that we might go from rags to riches. You know, someone defined God's grace using the acronym GRACE. Grace. He says, the grace of God is this: God's riches at Christ's expense. GRACE. God's riches at Christ's expense. Amen? We have been forgiven at the expense of Jesus. We now have eternal life at the expense of Jesus. We are sure to go to heaven when we die at the expense of Jesus. Sometimes we take this for granted. And we all only get to remember this when Holy Week comes. And we show you excerpts from the movie, The Passion of the Christ. Another depiction. Then we realize, whoa, that was not easy after all. Right? But this is the truth. We have what we have right now at the expense of Jesus. That is sacrificial giving. God's riches at Christ's expense. God's generosity on the first Christmas was perfect, was a perfect and lavish demonstration of his grace. We cannot outgive the Lord. Amen? Can you outgive the Lord? I can. Let me tell you this. If God will tell me, okay, you sacrifice your, perhaps your daughter, I don't have a son. You sacrifice your daughter for something, in all likelihood, I would say to the Lord, no way, Lord. No way. Right? Would you? Who among you here are parents? Raise your hands. Parents? Yes. Let me ask you this question. If God one day asked you to sacrifice your son or your daughter, would you? For something, whatever it is. Would you? I tell you, up front, now, I wouldn't. Really? Why would I? It's not easy. But guess what? God sacrificed His one and only Son. It must have broken the heart of God to see His Son bearing all the sins of the world when He is so holy. And He is God, He didn't have to sacrifice in any way. But that's God's riches at the expense, at Christ's expense, the grace of God. And that is the ultimate example of giving that He wants us to follow. Sacrificial kind of giving. Of course, we can never, you know, fully imitate the example of the Lord, because in the first place, we are not God. Even if we will give our children, we will sacrifice our children for the work of God, I tell you, that's still not enough. That is still not comparable to what God did, because He is God. Just imagine God sacrificing His Son. That's different from a human being sacrificing His Son. Okay? So we cannot fully imitate it. However, by His grace, in my many years in the ministry and in the church, I see some believers or a number of believers essentially reflecting the same thing in their lives. They are sacrificial givers. They don't have much, or maybe they have much, but they gave way beyond their ability or is expected of them, showing that they have this sacrificial heart. Many, many years ago, there was this group of teenage girls. They were believers, and they were raising funds for the missions. They wanted to support some missionary and mission organizations. And so they started with this amount of money. Later, they said, oh, this is not enough. We want to add more to this fund. And so they said, why don't we form a special club? And let's call this club the Do Without Club. Do you know why they call their club the Do Without Club? Because they say, we will decide to forego something that we now have in our lives, say a possession or a habit, we will do without them, or we will forego them and use the money that we will spend on them to give to missions. Are you following? That's why they call their club the Do Without Club. They will sacrifice something to give to missions. And during this time, most of the members of this Do Without Club came from well-to-do families. So it was really easy for them to find ways to contribute. You know, one said, okay, I'm not going to have my coffee for 2 weeks at a fancy coffee shop. And instead of going there, I'll take the money and give it to missions. It's sacrifice on her part, right? But that's easy. Okay? She still has so many luxuries at home because she comes from a well-to-do family. The other one said, okay, I'm not going to buy clothes for the whole month because she buys clothes every week. She comes from a well-to-do family. Again, that is sacrificial, right? But that's just easy for her because she goes back, she opens her closet, and she has all these beautiful clothes and all the luxuries in life. However, there was this one teenage girl among them who was not a rich girl. She actually was coming from a poor family. Her name was Margie. And so she thought, Lord, what is it that you want me to do without? You see, she was poor, really. Meaning, she was just living on the basic necessities of life. If you're just living on the basic necessities of life, what is it that you can do without? I mean, food, you will not eat, right? And so she thought. One day she knelt by her bed and she prayed to the Lord, Lord, please show to me what I can do without so that I can also give sacrificially to you. While she was doing that, all of a sudden, her pet dog came over to her side and started to lick her hand. And while the dog was doing that and while she was praying, all of a sudden, she remembered that some time ago, their family doctor offered to buy the dog for $50. And then while she remembered that thing, all of a sudden she felt that God was convicting her to sacrifice the dog. I mean, sell the dog and take the money out of the the sales and give it to missions. When she sensed that the Lord was convicting her to do that, tears started to flow from her eyes. You see, she loved the dog. Who among you have dogs? Pet dogs you love so much. Not those askal, okay? Asongkal, that you just kick. Not those dogs. You know, the dog that you really love, that you regard as your best friend, right? Imagine selling that for missions. It's like a human being. To those of you who are dog lovers, it's like a human being, right? It's like a member of the family. Now, here she was, convicted by God to give it away, sell it away. So she was so, you know, so sad. She started to cry. But then the Lord reminded her of the verse, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son." And so she said, "Yes, Lord, I'll do it." So the next thing, she brought the dog to the family doctor and sold the dog for $50. She went home, gave the money to missions. The doctor was so happy. You see, for some time now, he had been bugging this lady to sell the dog to him. Finally, she agreed. And so he was very happy. However, after some time, the doctor started to wonder. "It's very interesting," he said, "because this girl didn't want to sell this dog before. She resisted my offer. What made her change her mind?" The doctor said, "Maybe there was a pressing need, an urgent need that forced her or caused her to sell the dog." And so the doctor decided to drop by her house, and she talked to the teenage girl, and Margie explained what happened. And when he heard it, he was deeply touched. He was moved by the sacrificial heart of this teenage girl, so much so that he decided to return the dog without getting back his money. What's that? Sacrificial giving. I tell you, it's one thing to give, it's another thing to give sacrificially, right? It's also one thing to give something that you don't like anymore, or you don't need anymore. It's something else to give something that you love, you want, you need. That is sacrificial giving. Many, many years ago, there was this Christian by the name of John Wanamaker, a Christian businessman, an American Christian businessman. One day, he decided to make a trip to China. You see, he was an ardent supporter of China missions. I don't know, during this time, maybe he was thinking that the funds that he was sending to China was not being used well by missionaries. So he said, "I want to see it for myself, how my money was being used." And so off he went to China. When he got to China, he came upon an old man plowing the field. Okay. And he was surprised. You know why? Because he saw that the plow was being pulled by an ox and a young man. Can you picture it with me? The plow of the old man was being pulled by an ox and a young man. Now, here in the Philippines, our plows are being pulled by just one carabao, right? Just one carabao or one water buffalo. But back in China, they used two oxen to pull the plow. When he saw this picture, he was surprised. He said, "Where's the other cow or where's the other ox? Why is it that we have one ox and a young man together with the ox pulling the plow?" And so he talked to the old man, and the old man explained. He said, "You know, my brother, this is what happened. You see, our chapel, you know, we needed a spire or a steeple for our chapel. You see, our place is, our church is located in a not very conspicuous area. And our worshipers come from miles away. And it's very hard for them to locate our place. So we wanted to have a steeple or a spire. You know that tall, tapering structure that they built on top of a church tower? You know that thing? They said we wanted to have that. And so we prayed, and we gave, but after some time, the money was still not enough. And so we were, really sad. And then the old man said, one day my son came up to me, and he said, "Father, I have an idea. Why don't we sell one of our oxen and take the money from the sales and contribute to the buying of the steeple or the spire?" The old man said to his son, "We can't do that, son. This is our bread and butter. We need the ox. We cannot have just one ox. We need two oxen to plow the field." But the young man said, "No problem, father. Don't worry. I'll take the place of the ox that we sell." When John Wanamaker heard the story behind, tears started to flow from his eyes. He couldn't imagine someone could be this sacrificial. While he was thinking, how are they using my money out there? He's a Christian businessman contributing to missions. While he was wondering, he doesn't know the sacrifices of the missionaries and even believers out there. So when he heard this story, he said to the Lord, "Lord, let me be hitched to a plow that I may know also the joy of sacrificial giving." That's the kind of giving the Lord wants us to do. Let's level up. For those of you already doing that, that's good. We are so encouraged. We are inspired by that example. For those of you who are not yet doing that, let's level up. Amen? Let's do this for the Lord. Great will be our reward in heaven. How is our giving? Are we giving only at our convenience? Do we give only when we have extra? Do we give only when we don't need that money? Or do we give only when it doesn't trouble us? Or do we give even when it hurts? That's a tall order for all of us. I tell you, we all struggle in that area. Many surveys have been made in the U.S. on how much people give to charity, like churches and orphanages, percentage-wise. Okay? And here are the results of the surveys. The results basically are the same. Essentially, they are the same. Low to mid-income people give more than the rich do. Did you hear that? In the States, and I believe it's the same thing here in the Philippines, low to mid-income people give more than the rich people do percentage-wise. The rich people are giving out of their abundance. The poor people are giving out of their poverty. And that is not only true of us nowadays. Even before the time of Jesus Christ, this was already happening. One time Jesus Christ was at the temple, and he was sitting on the side, and he was observing how people were bringing in their offerings. And this is what happened. Look at me in Mark chapter 12, verse 41 to 44. "And Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the people putting money into the offering box. Many rich people put in large sums, and a poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which make a penny. And he called his disciples to him and said to them, 'Truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the offering box. For they all contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty has put in everything she had, all she had to live on.'" Would we still give if we don't have extra money? Would we still give if we have not reached our financial goal for this year or for this month? Think about that. You have to understand, widows back in Israel lived very miserable lives because the women during the time didn't work. So once the husband dies, they're practically dead also. Who will feed them? And many young men died because of wars at the time. So they also didn't have sons. But the Word of God says, you know, she out of her poverty has put in everything she had, all she had to live on. I'm just wondering, what's with having more that makes us give less to God? Have you ever thought about that? This is a struggle of many people, including me, by the way. What's with having more that makes us give less to the Lord? Many would say, oh, Pastor Rich, once I get this deal, once my business grows, I will give more. Listen, I've said the same line before. Lord, if my salary or my support will grow this big, I will give more. Not necessarily. That's not a guarantee. Actually, the opposite tendency is true. Once we have more, the harder it is for us to give. So I ask the question, what's with having more that makes us want to give less? Is it greed? Is it the love of money? Is it selfishness? Right? There was this guy who had a problem. One day he came to his pastor. He said, Pastor, I am in a difficult situation. I have this problem. The pastor said, why don't you share it with me? He said, you know what, Pastor? When I was only earning this much, only earning a little, I was giving only this little. Now that my business has grown, I have to give millions. Before it was only hundreds. Now it's millions. The pastor says, that's your problem? He said, yes, Pastor. What do you do with this? I'm really struggling. I have a hard time bringing out millions. The pastor said, no problem. Let me pray for you, brother. And so they prayed. The pastor said, Lord, I pray for this brother of mine. I pray that you will no longer bless him that much so that he should not give much to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You want that? Do you want to be blessed more? Of course. But listen to this. To whom much given, much is required. I would rather choose to be blessed more and give more than to be blessed less. I would rather be the one to give to others than to sit down and wait for others to help me because I have so little. Right? So brothers and sisters, this Christmas time, I encourage all of you, let's all give sacrificially. Okay? Let's challenge ourselves. Let's just not give extras. Let's give sacrificially. You know, giving out something that we like, we love. Let's try it. I tell you, it's a whole different joy that you will experience in your heart. When we give sacrificially, it is the time when we truly reflect the generosity of the Lord Jesus Christ.